Right. Good morning. Good morning. Happy Easter. He is risen. Amen. Amen. Yes, we have reason to praise God this morning because our God is alive and he is with us. Praise God. Praise God. This is what it says in Luke. This is what it says on the day that he was risen. This is what it says. It says, very early in the morning on the first day of the week, the women went to the tomb bringing fragrant spices that they had prepared for him. And they found something. They found a stone rolled away from the tomb. But they went in, and they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. They didn't know what to make of this. And suddenly, two men were standing beside them in gleaming bright clothes. The women, they were frightened. They bowed their faces toward the ground. But the men said to them, why do you look for the living among the dead? He isn't here, but he is raised. He has risen indeed. Remember what he has told you while he was still in Galilee, that the human one must be handed over to sinners, be crucified, and on the third day, rise again. Amen, amen, rose again. They remembered his words. They returned from the tomb, and they reported all these things to the 11 and others. Let us spend time in prayer before we start this morning. Father God, we lift you up, and we praise you for this morning. We thank you that you hear our prayers because you are living. You are with us. You love us. You have created us. You have given us life, God. You are the God of peace. You are the God of love. You are the God of hope. You are the God of, you are our Father in heaven, oh God. You are our brother. You are a friend, God. You are with us. You are protector, redeemer. You are all things. You are the mighty I am. God, we don't come here accidentally. We come here on purpose this morning to praise your name and lift you up because we love you and we know that you are the way, the truth, and the life. Be with us this morning, Spirit. Fill this room. Knit us together in love and hope. And we praise your name, Jesus. Amen, 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 amen. We are going to transition. We have a special performance. It's titled Pilate's Decision by Tim Lucas Jr.
I'm here to talk to you about a man called Jesus. As you can see, there was a crowd, much like this one. Well, only a much bigger crowd. As you can see, I gave the people a choice of which prisoner I could release. You see, the choice was either Barabbas or Jesus of Nazareth. Who should I release? I asked the crowd. Give us Barabbas, they cried out. What should I do about Jesus? I asked. Crucify him, they cried out once more. Unbelievable. I mean, what crime has this man done to be crucified? I asked. I found no fault in him. No fault whatsoever. I just want to give people what they want. So, I've had Jesus last 39 times. So, after Jesus was whipped, battered, and crowned, I have shown him to the people. What? They would still have their king to be crucified? I asked. Well, I gave the people a choice. So, just to make myself clear, I washed my hands of the entire situation and had Jesus crucified. You know, there was something incredible about Jesus of Nazareth. But I couldn't put my finger on it. What could it be? What do you think?
Well, good morning, everybody. How we doing? Y'all ready to praise the Lord a little bit? I don't know. Can y'all hear me? Y'all ready to praise the Lord a little bit? Can y'all put your hands together for my son, Tim Jr., real quick? Come on. Great job. Now, I know it's a little tight in here, and everybody got their Sunday clothes on, but go ahead and greet your neighbor. Say hello, neighbor. You're looking good today. Greet somebody else. Say hello, neighbor. You're looking good today. Now y'all can stand up, clap your hands, and join in with us as we do this. There we go. Real simple song. Goes like this.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praise of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
Sound good? Come on, do that again.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praise of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
We cry, oh,
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 oh, let it rise.
Good.
We cry, oh,
oh, let it rise.
We're going to do that one again.
Let the glory of the Lord say,
let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praise of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
Let the glory of the Lord say,
let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord among us. Let the praise of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
We cry, oh,
oh, oh, let it rise.
We cry, oh,
oh,
put your hands together. We got another one. Let the songs of the Lord, here we go.
Let the songs of the Lord say,
let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the praise of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
Let the songs of the Lord say, rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King
rise among us. Let it rise.
We cry, oh,
oh, oh, oh, let it rise.
We cry, oh,
oh.
We got one more. We're going to let the dance of the Lord. Let the dance of the Lord say.
Let the dance of the Lord rise among us. Let the dance of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
Let the dance of the Lord say.
Let the dance of the Lord. Rise among us, let it rise.
We cry,
oh, oh, let it rise.
Last time, here we go.
We cry, oh,
oh, let it rise.
Come on, magnify the name of the Lord.
Y'all in here, and it should be louder than that on Resurrection Sunday. Good morning, Unity. So good to see you this morning. Please give it up for our praise team. Dr. Lucas, Young Minister Lucas, ushering us into worship on this Resurrection Sunday. Like, this is
Amen.
This is our all-star
Amen.
Sunday as yeah. believers, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
He got
yeah.
up.
He got up.
The stone was rolled away. Yeah. He came from heaven to earth.
Yeah.
Showed the way. From the earth to the cross. Our debt to pay. From the cross to the grave. From the grave to the sky.
Uh-huh.
We lift your name on high. Y'all know the song, right? Just that part. We should be singing that, right?
He came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Give it up for the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Amen. He has risen. And because of that, we have the gift of salvation. Amen. Announcements this morning?
Yeah, we got one announcement.
Just one?
I forgot what it was, though.
Okay.
Yeah, I did. I forgot.
I'm going to just go through mine. And midweek discipleship, Wednesday at 6:30. Right, Ryder? Where's Ryder? Yes, 6:30. On Wednesday, online or in the building. So come join us or join us online. Amen.
Amen.
Clothes, donations, food donations. We are accepting them. So we are starting a food pantry and a clothes closet upstairs. Amen. So we are accepting donations of gently used or new clothes. If they're used, please make sure they're clean. Amen. And then non-perishable food items. We're going to stock this thing up, and then we're going to let anybody in the community come and get what they need. Amen. Next month, or even this month, if you want, we're going to start accepting donations for our summertime survival kits. Y'all know what it is. Summertime survival kits, we give away boxes throughout the summer months to help families kind of bridge the gap, right? So the kids come home, and for some reason, they eat all day long, from sun up to sundown, and sometimes in the middle of the night, if they were like our kids. Amen. We provide a box to help with breakfast. I'm sorry, Eli, your sister not here to bear the brunt with you this morning. But she is serving. Yes. Amen. She's serving at her church in Falls Church. And we told her, like my father and my grandfather told me, you don't have to come to my church as long as you're serving somewhere. Amen. So we do those boxes. They contain breakfast items and lunch items. It's a big box. We can't usually even get it taped really good because we try to fill it up, cereal and oatmeal and granola bars and juicy juices and Chef Boyardee, all the things, right? Chips, amen. They love the chips, amen. So we'll start accepting monetary donations for those as well. We like to do it June, July, August. Now, if we get generous donations, we'll even try to do it in May. Amen. So I think that's all I have. Oh, outreach team, we are having a meeting after church next Sunday, immediately after church. So if you're part of the outreach team, you know about it because we've already talked about it in our group. If you're interested in being in the outreach team, you can join us. Amen. So that's all I have for announcements on this morning, except for I'm a mom, so I can't help it. I'm just happy to have my son here from Hampton. Amen. And his girlfriend, his lady, Nia. Amen. And I know some of y'all didn't recognize him because all his hair was gone, but he became an alpha man last Sunday. Amen. So we're just proud of you. So proud. And we beat it out here last Sunday. So that is why, if anybody was wondering, because we did leave out here smoking. Amen.
Won't you look at your neighbor and pass them an Earhart? We want to pass everybody an Earhart. Make sure you know that they are loved in the house of the Lord. Yeah. Some of y'all got some air circles. I need an air heart. There you go. Pops, that looks like a gang sign.
You got to do a little curve with it.
Amen. Amen.
Got to do a little curve with it.
Amen.
Were you asking for Pops' shoes? Is that what you were pointing to?
Yeah. Amen.
Because he's clean this morning. Easter clean. Amen.
How many people are excited that you have a new opportunity called today? Come on, somebody. We are glad to see everyone. For those who come often, good to see you again. For those who do not come often, it's good to see you. I want you to, real quick before I sit down, I want you to find a neighbor that's going to talk to you, and I want you to tell them something, okay? Find you a neighbor. Make sure you have a neighbor. Does everybody have a neighbor? Mamas, you got you a neighbor? Okay, I want you to repeat after me. See ya. See ya. Next Sunday. All right, all y'all Easter babies, come on back.
Do we have a video? Do we have a video for Women's History or no? Yes? No? Yeah. Okay, that was the last announcement. So March, Women's History Month, it's fifth Sunday, but it's still March, and we do have a video from the Women's Ministry to show. So we'll let that play as we go to our seats, right? Amen. Amen. Happy Sunday, y'all.
Seen the movie Sybil? It's from the 1970s. It's super scary. It's a true story about a woman with dissociative disorder or multiple personalities. Trust me on this, guys. Even on their worst days, your wives or girlfriends are nothing like Sybil. I know, because I was like Sybil. I was possessed with seven evil spirits.
Although it is easy to speculate that Mary Magdalene may have been a woman of ill repute, It is more likely that she was the most faithful of all of Jesus' followers.
The Bible doesn't say when I became demon-possessed or how I behaved, but use your imagination. Depending on which evil spirit to control, I could be passive or aggressive, quiet or violent, or behave as the most wanton woman in town. In fact, that particular demon was in control of my life one summer day. I sat on the outskirts of town to lure men into my evil life. Jesus and his disciples walked by as they were traveling from Cana to Capernaum, and I accosted them. Jesus rebuked the demon, and I fell to the ground. Just fainted. When I awoke, he took my hand and helped me stand and told me to go and sin no more. Jesus. From that day on, I began to follow Jesus from a distance just to hear what he had to say and to serve him in any way that I could. This story may help you imagine my life. The Bible only says 3 things about me before the crucifixion of Jesus. Although commentators and painters have imagined much more. The Bible says that my name is Mary, called Magdalene. It says that I was cured of 7 demons. And it said that I supported Jesus out of my own means. My name has come to be Mary Magdalene. Many commentators believe that means I came from Magdala, a small fishing village on the west shore of the Sea of Galilee. That village's synagogue was rediscovered in 2009, and the village is now an archaeological wonder and an important tourist site. It is certain that Jesus traveled by Magdala when he traveled on the path from Capernaum to Nazareth or Tiberias. Luke wrote that 7 demons came out of me, while Mark wrote that Jesus had driven them out. You can be assured that the demons were fixed on my destruction. I was one of the first women to follow Jesus, but far from the last. I was a faithful follower of Jesus until the end of his life. I am not exaggerating. I watched at a distance with other followers while Jesus hung on the cross and died. I watched Joseph of Arimathea place the body of Jesus in a tomb and roll the large stone over the entrance. At dawn of the Sunday after Jesus was killed, Mary and I went to the tomb. There was a violent earthquake. And an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and rolled the enormous stone away from the tomb. Then he sat on it, on top of the stone. It was so scary that the guards of the tomb passed out like dead men. He spoke to us, to women. Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here. He's risen. We ran to tell the disciples of the good news before we had gone far. Jesus appeared to us. He told us not to be afraid. Not to be afraid, but to tell his disciples to meet him in Galilee. I finally got to the disciples to tell them.
And I started with the greatest piece of news in the history of mankind. I have seen the Lord. I have seen the Lord.
I remember when he saved my life. Everything before that was just a blur. I was wild, living real foul. I just want right. I remember when he changed my name. From sick to healed, from broke to blessed. Now I can testify that I'll never be the same. Truth is, I should be crazy. I thank God he saved me. I'm a living witness that God, yeah. That's why I believe. I'm not ashamed to tell the head of my life. I want to thank you. If it had not been for you, I could have died last year, thinking about the last tears, thinking about the last time that I called on you, and you came through. I remember when my God is amazing. Thank you.
Time we want y'all to sing with us.
Here we go.
Sing.
Bread of heaven,
sent down from glory.
Sent down from glory.
Say many things,
many things. You were on earth, a holy king, a carpenter. You are.
Say bread of heaven.
Sent down from glory.
Sent down from glory. Say many things.
Many things. You were on earth, a holy king, a carpenter. You are the
awesome ruler.
Awesome ruler.
Gentle redeemer.
Gentle redeemer.
Say God with us.
God with us.
The living true. And what a friend we have in you.
You are the
awesome ruler.
Awesome ruler.
Gentle redeemer.
Gentle redeemer.
Say God with us.
God with us.
The living true. And what a friend we have in you. Say Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus. That's what we call you. Manger born, put on a tree. You died to save humanity.
Say Jesus, Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus.
Come on.
That's what we call you. Manger born, put on a tree. You died to save humanity.
Come on, somebody give God some praise. That'd be good if we were praising for the final four. I'm talking about for the only one. Somebody give God some praise. It is an absolute blessing to see every single one of you. It is my hope and my desire that this is not going to be the only time that we see you. We access this particular service online, so you don't even have to leave your home. Bible says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Let there be liberty at your house while you praise the Lord at home. Amen. Children are being released to Children's Church now. If you are so inclined, please allow them to go. Don't worry, that's the timer, because they said, preacher, we want you to preach quick. So now I can look at the timer and make sure I'm okay. Resurrection Sunday is always an interesting Sunday because from a church's vantage point, you see people that you may not customarily see, and it is then incumbent upon you to make sure you bring it. You bring it. So I hope that this is something that you can ruminate on, chew on, so that when you leave this place, you'll be better than when you came in. Amen? I'm gonna go ahead and low-key brag real quick. My daddy here, and so I'm just going to honor my daddy. Miss Maria, I love you dearly, ma'am. Thank you for bringing him, because I know you brought him. Open up your Bibles, if you will, to Matthew 27. Matthew 27. So I rushed out of here last Sunday. So I had to, Craig, I had to fast forward that thing. I'm going to take a little bit of time, even though they got the timer. D, if you hit that light bulb button, it'll make it brighter as well. Because I might take too long just because I don't see it. Wink, wink. Hallelujah. I'm in Matthew chapter 27. I'm going to read verse 55. When you have it, can you say amen? It reads thusly. Now when the centurion, Matthew 27, 54, I apologize. Now when the centurion and they that were with him were watching Jesus, when they saw the earthquake and all of those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this man was the Son of God. I want to preach for a moment what I hope all of us are preaching in one shape, form, or fashion this Sunday on Resurrection Sunday, convicted at the foot of the cross. Convicted at the foot of the cross. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I thank you. I bless you, Lord. As I think about your goodness and all that you've done for me, my soul has no choice but to cry out, hallelujah. As we stand in your midst today, God, we realize it wasn't fancy alarm clocks that woke us up, Lord, but it was you. Even now, God, we just pray, Lord, that you would have your way. Let my words be subjugated to your words. Likewise, my thoughts, Lord, that what is seen and done, what is heard would be of you. That you would transform us by the washing of the word. That you would instruct us and guide us, O Lord. That you would unify us, God, and that we would know that you are God. Have your way, O God, in this moment. And as you do it, O Lord, be also careful to give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on, somebody. Mm-hmm. Convicted at the foot of the cross. I think that part of the problem is that many of us, though in the church, do not fully understand what it means to be convicted. And because we don't fully understand what it means to be convicted, we will never be able to truly exercise our faith. What do you mean by that, preacher? When most of us hear the word convict, we think of convict. We think of someone who is an ex-convict. And so we focus our attention on persons who are proven to be guilty of a crime. We also focus on the act of trying to prove someone's guilty of a crime. Therefore, our theology and faith becomes an exercise in trying to prove people are guilty and wrong. Talk to me. We spend more time in the church trying to declare and prove that people are sinners and try to put them down instead of building them up. I know I'm in the right church. You can go ahead and be quiet all you want, because when they walk in with a skirt that you didn't buy, that you might think is a little too short, you want to convict. When they come and talk to you and their breath smells like a Henny and a C, you might want to try to judge them and talk down to them. When you hear they're having problems on their marriage, even though you had problems with yours, you are busy trying to point the finger and convict. I don't hear nobody. The church has become a place not where we build people up, but where we tear people down, all in the name of conviction. I wish I had a witness in here. There were some people who tried to look at my life and convict me too. But thanks be to God that God is the, I wish I had a witness, is the only judge. You can say what you want about me, but if God says I'm okay, I am okay. So go ahead with your bad self. You might not like where I hang out. Go ahead with your bad self. You might not like what I'm listening to. Go ahead with your bad self. You might not like my haircut, my tattoos, or even the way I talk. But thanks be to God that God ain't you, and that even though you said I'm not important, God has called me an MVP. Do I have some people up in here? I'm God's MVP. I'm God's VIP. That at the end of the day, no matter how I fall, God still loves me. That's an Easter message, right? There, that when people are trying to dog you because they think they got your number, you can tell them, I blocked you, baby. God is all right with me. Can I get some praises this morning who say to themselves, I will not be convicted? Not like that. Not like that. Because here it is, when you look at it on a more base level, go back to John 8, 9, you'll find a particular story about a woman who was caught in the act of adultery. And there were Sadducees who decided that they wanted to convict this woman who was caught in the crime. This is what I think is really funny about it. She was convicted of the crime, but they never took the time to get her co-conspirator. This is how I know some people really don't care about whether or not you're doing right or wrong anyway. They just trying to pick, because they never took the time to get the man who was also in sin with them. I'm trying to help somebody this morning. Here's a message to you. Don't you worry about people, because they're not always out for what they say they're out for. They brought her to him to convict her. And you know that the judgment for adultery was stoning. And so they brought her before Jesus, hoping that Jesus would declare that she was convicted and stone her. Jesus turned the tables around and Jesus said, let he who has cast the first sin of he who has sinned cast the first stone. I wish I had a neighbor in here. You've been doing the same thing I did. You just don't have the energy to do it no more. You were going the same places I went. They just don't want you no more. You were trying to back it up and smack it up. But thanks be to God, I'm just trying to help you this morning. Because we're so judgy, Jesus said, listen, I know you don't even care about what in the world she did. And so he who has not sinned, let them cast the first stone. And do you know that everybody sat there all dumbfounded and confuzzled, looking like they had a whole bunch of peanut butter in their mouth, because they realized at the end of the day, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory. Church should be a place where we can all testify that I once was lost in sin. But Jesus came in and pulled me from the bottom to the top. Now I'm here. I wish I had a neighbor. Do I have some church folk in the house that realize I was bound up and tied up, but Jesus loosed me up, and now I raise my hands up and give God some praise? Do I have a witness this morning? While everybody else is talking about Easter bunnies, I'm going to talk about a God who reached way down in the grave and came out the grave so I can be dead no more. I wish I had a church in here. You might lean on Dr. Phil. Other people might lean on Oprah. You might lean on Brother Lester. But I lean on the Most High God. Come on. Lean with it. Rock with it. I thanks be to God this morning that I am a nobody trying to tell everybody about somebody who can save anybody. Where my praises at? He can save anybody. My grandmama, he can save her. My crack baby, he can save them. My uncle, he can save them. Pull the cigarette out their mouth, save them. Get them out the club, save them. I know a God that specializes in saving. The particular word is elekro, eglekro in the Greek. And all it means is proof. That particular text, when it uses that word in 8:9, it says their conscience convicted them. Their conscience proved to them that they had no business levying the accusation. Why is this important, church mama? Because what it means is that we can not only be convicted or convinced of wrongdoing, but we can also be convinced of right doing. I wish I had a witness in here. I wish I had a church this morning that was more convinced or just as convinced of God's grace and God's goodness and God's authority and God's power as they are of the sin and wrongdoing in people's lives. As long as the church specializes in convicting people of wrong and never showing people how to be convinced of God's right, they will never come to the church. They will never see the Lord. They will never walk in authority. They will never have love. Are you convinced? Because here it is, for us to exercise our true faith, we must not only be convinced of who we are or who we are not, but we must be especially convinced of who God is. Look at a neighbor and tell them, do you know him? It's not just important that you know who you are and who you are not, but that you also know who God is. I wish I had a church that knew who God is, because God is not a sidekick to the Easter Bunny or Santa Claus. God is not your get out of hell free card. I'm trying to help somebody. God is not just some simple addendum, some box you check just to make you feel good about yourself. Jesus is much more than we make him out to be. He's bigger than that Bible that you never read. He's bigger than the building that you worship in. He's bigger bigger than the scripture you can quote. I'm trying to help you out. Who is Jesus? He is the lily of the valley. Who is Jesus? He is the resurrection and the life. Who is Jesus? He is the way, the truth, and the light. Who is Jesus? He is the good shepherd. Who is Jesus? He's the bread of life. Who is Jesus? He's the bright and morning star. Who is Jesus? He is the living water. Who is Jesus? He's the bishop of my soul. Who is Jesus? He is my redeemer. Who is Jesus? He is the only begotten son coming from God. Who is Jesus? I'm trying to help somebody. I don't know who he is to you, but Jesus is the one who wiped my tears away at night. Who is Jesus? The one who takes care of me in the hospital. Who is Jesus? The one that helps my troubled mind. Who is Jesus? The one that gives me strength when I'm tired. Who is Jesus? The one who wakes me up in the morning. Who is Jesus to you? We don't know him. We don't know him. We're not convinced of who he is. And so when we find ourselves in the midst of trouble, we don't really believe that God will supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory in who? Christ Jesus. We don't really believe when the world around us is crazy that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. We don't truly believe because we think we know it all when really we don't know anything at all. Who is Jesus? If we can answer any question on Resurrection Sunday, it has to be who is Jesus? Because if we don't answer that particular question as to who Jesus is, we will never be able to fully exercise our relationship with God. So I don't mind you shouting, go ahead and shout. I don't mind you clapping, go ahead and clap. I don't mind you singing, go ahead and sing. I don't mind the fellowship, go ahead and fellowship. But at the end of the day, the question has to be, do you know Jesus? I want to look in the text real quick because I don't want you to think I'm making something up, because the critical question becomes, all right, how in the world then do you know what you know that you know? What does it take for me to truly be convicted of who God is? Somebody say, I know that's right. We look at this particular text and we're finding Jesus who has gone around all night after being falsely accused because some folks were jealous of him. I'm going to go ahead and leave it alone. I ain't got time for it today. I need you to understand everybody that's smiling your face ain't necessarily your friend. I'm trying to help somebody. Just because they pop up on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, don't mean they're your boy or your... I'm trying to help somebody. Just because they say they're your boo don't mean that they really your boo. They just your boo when they around you. You'll catch that when you go home. That's all right. I'm trying to help you this morning. They decided they wanted to get rid of Jesus. And so what they did was they took one of those in his inner circle. Y'all better watch this. He took one of those in his inner circle. Y'all better watch this. They took one of those that was in his inner circle and they gave him money. In other words, hashtag, he sold them out. I'm trying to help you out here. You might be my friend, but you got one time to sell me out. Amen, right there. You got one time to sell me out. Listen here. God is a God that loves everybody, but God doesn't give access to everybody. You got to meet a certain criteria to be in the presence of God. I wish I could help somebody here. So they get him and they carry him all over the place. They beat this man all night. They talk about him. They tell him to prophesy. They strip him of his clothes. And they put him on the cross. They put him on the cross. They put him on the cross. And a whole lot of things happen on the cross. The sky begins to blacken and a whole lot of stuff goes down. And by the time this man... this God man, you'll catch that on the way home, because he had to be God enough to be the propitiation, the payment for our sins, but he had to be man enough to be equal as a sacrifice for our sins. Mm-hmm. And so he dies, and the man, the centurion, the soldier who had probably watched all of these events said, truly, this was the Son of God. Now, mind you, he didn't say that when they were putting the crown of thorns in his head. Mind you, they didn't say that when they were stripping his clothes and gambling for his clothes. Mind you, he didn't say that when he pierced him in the side. I wish I had a witness. Mind you, they didn't say that when they were driving the nails in his wrists and the nails in his feet. I'm trying to help somebody, because there are going to be some people after this day who were trying to crucify you, that once God is done with you, they're going to be able to say, you know what? I'm sorry for what I did. Truly, this person is a person of God. I'm trying to help somebody. If God is for me, who can be against me? Some of us are too busy worried about who's against you. By the time the tables flip, they're going to know that God is on your side. What was it that made this soldier different from the criminal, the malefactor who was on the cross right beside him? Say it again. What was it that made him different from the criminal, from the malefactor that was right beside him? I'm so glad you asked. Because both of them were close to Christ, but only one of them saw Christ. There we go again. I'm trying to help somebody, baby. Because just because they sit in the pews don't mean they know God. Just because they got a cross around their neck don't mean they know God. Just because they open the Bible and quote scripture don't mean they know God. Just because they, hey, I'm in the kitchen, that don't make me a cook. I'm trying to help you up in here. Everybody don't necessarily know God. Thank you, D. Thank you. It was his vantage point. Because while the criminal was on the cross right beside God, thinking that we're both in the same condition, thinking we're both in the same boat, thinking that I'm equal with God, the centurion was down on the bottom looking up. I wish I had a witness in here. Some of us in trouble. And when you find yourself in trouble, you better learn. Stop looking around you and learn to look up. Nothing can stop me. He's all the way up. I wish I had a praiser up in here. Once you learn to look to the hills from which cometh your help, you'll learn your help cometh from the Lord. It was his vantage point, because many times we find ourselves looking down at people and looking down at God. Come on, tell yourself the truth. You don't really say it with your mouth, because that would be ugly. But in our actions, we prove every day, not my will, my will be done, God. And you do what I want you to do, but you have flipped it. You have reversed it. You have cursed it. God's intention is for us to do his will. And so when we see God, come on, like the preacher Uzziah, you got to see the Lord high and lift. He sees him high and lifted up. But when we look at this particular scripture, it says, when the centurion, then they that were with him, saw the things that were done. Somebody say things that were done. What was done? I'm doing pretty good, Dana. That clock does work, man. Thank you. They saw the temple torn. The temple curtain torn. Tell your neighbor the temple curtain was torn. Go ahead, tell him. Tell the other neighbor, that one ain't talking to you right today. The temple curtain was torn. When you look at this particular scripture, you're going to be able to see it. It says that the temple was torn. The curtain from the top to the bottom tore. And what it symbolized, what it symbolized and embodied, was the tearing of the walls of religion. I'm trying to help you out here, because Pilate said this. He said he knew that they were trying to hang Jesus for envy. Religion was jealous of Jesus because Jesus had the true power and they had fake power. Religion wanted to silence Jesus because they weren't really talking about nothing. Religion wanted to get rid of Jesus because Jesus embodied relationship with God while they embodied a whole bunch of rules. You want to know what will kill the Spirit of God in a sanctuary? A whole bunch of religious folk that have no relationship with God. I wish I could help you out. Let me help you. There are hundreds of Levitical laws on the book. There was no way in the world that the people could follow the hundreds of laws. If they broke one, they were guilty of breaking them all. And so Christ had to come because the rule book couldn't do it. It was God who rules that was able to do it. I wish I had a church in here who would stop being so religious and get a relationship relationship with God. I don't hear nobody. It ain't about Sunday. It's about Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday again. It ain't about quoting scripture. The word have I hid in your heart that I may not sin against me. It's not about what you say. It's about what you do. Who is truly living for God? He tears the walls of religion down. And what we find is we'll find all the time, the Bible says it clearly, it is the rules of law, it is the traditions of man that make the word of God null and of no effect. And so while you trying to lay down law, God's trying to bring down the power. While you laying down law, God's trying to bring down your purpose. While you laying down law, God's trying to bring down your religion. But thanks be to God, I've been delivered from the law because I got the lawgiver inside of me. Do I have a church this morning who says I may not cross every T and dot every I? Do I have a church this morning? I may not wear a suit on Easter. Do I have a church this morning? I may not go to church every Sunday or Bible study every Wednesday, but I got Jesus in my, I wish I had a witness. I got Jesus in my heart. And because I got Jesus in my heart, I got Jesus in my feet. Because I got Jesus in my heart. I got Jesus in my hand. Because I got Jesus in my heart. I got Jesus in my mouth. Because I got Jesus in my heart. I got Jesus everywhere. I wish I had a church. I got Jesus. Miss me with all that religion. Miss me with all that religion. And I know some folk going to be real mad. But I hate to burst your theological bubble. God never called Jesus a Christian. He surely never called him Baptist or Pentecostal. He didn't belong to the Four Square Church. But Jesus was the Son of God. And God is God alone. When you get out of the little stuff, then you can finally get some big stuff. I'm trying to help somebody. What denomination are you? None. I'm the one who follows God. Are you Baptist? Are you Pentecostal? Do you shout? I'm a disciple. When you learn to be a disciple, your religion takes the back seat. Do you know how many wars have been fought in the name of religion? Do you know how many abortion clinics have been blown up in the name of religion? Do you know how many hungry people have been turned away in the name of religion? Do you know how many people who wanted to see God couldn't see God because of our nasty religion? Preach it, Paul. My righteousness, my religion is filthy rags. And when you realize you're just a speck of dirt like everybody else, then maybe you can let God work in you. The temple tore. That's why I'm convicted, because religion said I didn't belong. Religion said I wasn't qualified. Religion said I had to wait. Religion said I had to look a certain way. Religion said I had to talk a certain way. Religion said I had to move a certain way. But thanks be to God, religion didn't have the last word. Do I have some saints in here at the end of the day? Religion doesn't have the last say, but my relationship with God is the last say. And he said, I am fearfully and wonderfully made, and I'll serve the Lord. The temple wall tore because Christ tears down the walls of religion. When Christ comes back, I hate to tell you, you can read the Bible for yourself so you know I'm not lying. He's not coming back for the Christians. He's coming back for a church, an ecclesia without spot or wrinkle. Now, if you're a Christian and you ain't a part of the church, you're going to be in trouble. I wish I had a neighbor. I'm a part of the church and I can be a Christian, but I'm a part of the church first. Who y'all quiet up in here? Number one, he saw the temple curtain tear. Number two, he saw terrible tremors that changed the face of the terrain. Listen, I know that's a mouthful, but alliteration was on my mind last night. I hate to say it. Terrible tremors changed the face of the terrain. The Bible says that even though and after he saw the temple tear, the temple curtain tear, the next thing he saw were earthquakes. And the reason I bring this up, Pops, is because we think that we are standing on pretty solid ground till natural disasters hit. Oh, y'all quiet. Y'all think y'all doing good long as y'all got that good job and driving in that good car. Y'all think y'all doing good long as that 401k is in place and you got that poor fund. We think we doing good as long as we sitting on these nice soft purple seats on a Sunday morning. Everybody thinks they're on solid ground until the storm comes, until the marriage has some problems, until you get laid off on your job, until you get sick and put in the, I wish I had a witness, but thanks be to God, when the natural disaster comes, my house is not built on sand, but my house is built on the rock. So the winds may come and the waters may come, but my house is still going to stay. Some of y'all ought to praise God today, because after the rain, after the hurricane, after the storm, you still standing. Where my still standing believers at? Thanks be to God that I'm still standing. After I lost it all, I'm still standing. After they turned their back on me, I'm still standing. After they cussed me out, I'm still standing. After the doctor gave up on me, I'm still standing. I wish I had a church who's still standing on the word of God. Because see, that's the difference. That's the difference, sis. We all look the same until the storm comes. Some of us quit and walk away. Some of us lay down and die. But every now and then, I got some believers who believe in God more than they believe in their situation. I might look bad now, but I'm still standing. And if you're still standing, shout and give him glory. If you're still standing, give God some praise. If you're still standing, well, I'm still standing. Natural storms have a way of shifting our focus. But every now and then, you don't get to blame it on the devil. You don't get to blame it on natural forces. Every now and then, it's God who rocks our world. Every now and then, God rocks your world. Every now and then, God shifts your foundation so that the things you thought you believed, God shows you that that's not necessarily what it should be. I'm trying to help somebody here, because we believe you need to be evil to people who are evil to you. And God says, I need to rock your world. Love your neighbor, but also love your enemy. I'm trying to help somebody. Every now and then, we think we hoard our lives and we conserve our lives. But God comes and says, if you try to save your life, you'll lose it. But those who lose their life for the gospel will save it. I wish I had a witness up in here. God flips the script on us. Every now and then we think our might is right. But God says your strength, his strength, is made perfect in our weakness. And so we have to learn as believers to let God flip and rock our world so that we don't believe the things of the world, but instead believe the things of God. And it's hard because it's against culture. Culture tells you, you got money, get you some honeys. We ain't got no kids in here. Don't get mad. They upstairs at children's church. You chasing after red bottoms and 36, 26, 36. You chasing after muscles and Mercedes Benz. But God said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the other things you want shall be added to it. God disrupts our thought so that, like the soldier, man, I thought I knew what I was talking about, but now I believe something different. And do I have a church in here who has gotten to the place, man, I thought that if I did it this way, it was going to be okay, but now I believe something different. Man, I thought if I ate my vitamins and exercise every day, my health would be fine, but now I believe something different. But have you ever thought? I thought that if I came to church every Sunday, that everything would be all right. But now I believe something different. Thanks be to God. When God causes a seismic shift in our life, he doesn't abandon us, but he's still there. Why am I convicted at the foot of the cross? Because Christ has a way of causing a cataclysmic shift in my life. And can anybody remember what their world was like before they met God? And how God, he picked me up. Come on, somebody. He turned me around. He placed my feet on solid ground. You don't know what the Lord has. I wish I had a church in here. I ain't praising for you. You ain't praising for me. But can you praise for what God did for you? For waking you up this morning, for starting you on your way, for pulling you out of the miry clay. Can you praise God this morning? When my mama died, he showed up. When I lost my job, he showed up. When I lost my mind, he showed up. When he broke my heart, he showed up. I wish I had a church up in here. I got a God that when my life started turning, he set me on solid ground. The temple tore. Temple curtain tore. There were terrible tremors that changed the very terrain of the earth. Where there were mountains, there were no more mountains. Where there was ground, there was no more ground. If you allow God, God will change your entire landscape. I wish I had a witness. You don't like the way things are looking around you? Let God change your entire landscape. But lastly, what did this soldier see? This soldier saw tombstones being opened and told to testify. Follow me, walk with me just a little bit, just walk with me just a little bit more. I'm almost done, preacher, because I'm tired anyway. The tombstones opened and they were told to testify. Y'all better read the scripture. I need to put my glasses on, says, because I can't see without it. It says that the graves, I'm in verse 52, the graves were opened, and many of the bodies of the saints which slept arose, and they came out of the graves after resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many. I'm talking to somebody, because the greatest evidence of God's presence and God's existence is God's ability to raise the dead. Now, you want me to prove this to you? You think I'm just talking out the side of my face? Okay, Sister Maria, I got you. Why don't we think about the boy who was at Nain? Mama had already put him in the casket and filed him away. He was already outside of the walls of the city. And Jesus comes and interrupts the funeral. You know how folks get at their funerals. You come in here and start talking, and you ain't supposed to talk at my funeral. I'm afraid all the people in my family gonna lay holy and non-holy hands on you. I'm just trying to tell you how it's gonna go. Jesus comes in the middle of the funeral, and he does what rabbis should never do. He touched a dead thing. He put his hand on the coffin, and as he put his hand on the coffin, the guy burst out of the coffin and began to live. That ain't good enough for you. That's fine. There was another guy. He was a church guy. His name was Jairus. He had a daughter who was sick, and while Jesus was walking with Jairus, his daughter dies. The man who is working for Jairus says, "Hey man, your daughter died. Leave the master alone." And Jesus says to him, "Listen, don't fear, only believe." That's a word right there. That's an entirely different sermon another day, but I got to say it again anyway. Don't fear, only believe. I wish I had a church. Stop being scared. Stop being scared of people. Stop being scared of what might go wrong. Stop being scared of failing. Stop being scared. Jesus comes into the house. She's already dead. She's already dead. He already knows this. He comes in the house and they say, what are y'all doing here? This girl is dead. Jesus said, don't worry about it. Don't trip. Stop tweaking. She's only sleeping. And they start laughing at him. But this is what I like about Jesus' daddy. He kicked him out. Y'all don't know my dad, but every now and then when people acted up in his house, he kicked them out. He was like, get out, get out, get out. It reminded you of an episode of Martin. But there was a lesson in that he taught me. When there are people in your space that do not believe what you believe, then you need to tell them, get out, get out, get out. If they can't help you with your faith, if they can't help you with your money, if they can't help you with your family, if they can't help you be better, you need to kick them out. Some of us need company so bad we'll have people in our house that we know gonna tear up our house. Jesus walked in the house and kicked everybody else out. And he said to the little girl, Talitha Kumai, which is translated little damsel arise, which says to me, it don't matter how long you've been dead. When God speaks a word over your life, he who was dead shall live. I was dead in my addiction. I was dead in the trauma of my past. I was dead in the labyrinth of my own mind. I was dead, but God looked at me in my grave and in the darkness. God looked at me with the dirt all over me. God looked at me after the preacher had said the eulogy and said, this is not the end. Little boy, arise. And I wish I had some church folk this morning who once were dead, but now they're alive. Who once were bound, but now they're alive. Who once was in darkness, but now I'm alive. They didn't think I would make it, but I'm alive. They didn't think I could take it, but I'm alive. They didn't think I'd get better, but I'm alive. Do I have a church in here of dead men walking who are now alive? You know, they laid you down, Sister Sarah, and they start singing, slow singing and flower bringing. But thanks be to God that they did not have the last word. After they were singing, God had a song of his own. Love lifted me. Love lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted. Come on, y'all don't know the first verse. When I was seeking deep in sin, far from the crystal shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters lifted me. Now safe am I. Do I have a church? Love lifted me. Love lifted me when mama gave up on me. Love lifted me when auntie gave up on me. Love lifted me when my family gave up on me. Love lifted me when they didn't think I was qualified. Love lifted me. I don't hear nobody. And it's hard for us to fathom because we don't believe that raising the dead is really possible. Like even the Sadducees and the Pharisees fought over that, the two religious sects, whether or not there was resurrection. But God specializes in raising that which was dead back to life. I don't care if you ain't got a relationship with them. God can bring it back to life. I don't care how long you've been down on the bottom. God can bring it back to life. I don't care whether it or he or she has gripped you. God can bring it back to life. I don't care if you watch that dream die in your eyes. God can bring. I wish I had a church in here who would simply testify. God will bring it back to life. We give up too quick. We give up too quick. Because we think like Mary and Martha, John chapter 11, when he raised Lazarus, that just because we can't do it, God can't do it. But God does precisely what we can't do. Jesus has a way of encouraging those dead things, not only to rise, but to talk. I heard this in a sociological circles. If you see something, say something. Go ahead and say it. If you see something, say something. Yeah, go ahead and say it again. If you see something, say something. If you see something, say something. If you see something, say something. Now, normally, customarily, that is related to cases of abuse and being mandated reporters, that we are mandated to report. If we see something, we must say something. The same principle applies as it relates to your walk with God. If you have seen the goodness of the Lord, you ought to say something. If you have seen God deliver, you ought to say something. If you have seen God fight your battles, you ought to say something. If you have seen your life turn around, you ought to, where are the dead folks that are opening up their mouths and saying, I once was blind, but now I see. We post everything else on Facebook except what God has done for us. And you wonder why people don't believe. Because I see you talking about how you gonna cuss people out more than you talk about God. I see you talking about how you don't like your kids more than you talk about God. I see you talking about how you don't like your job that God gave you while other people are unemployed instead of talking about God. They overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And I'm watching the soldier at the bottom of the cross. He saw the temple tear. And if that wasn't good enough, he saw the terrible tremors absolutely shift and disrupt the terrain. And if that wasn't enough, he saw the tombstones open and talk. He saw enough for him to say, this ain't magic. This ain't Fox News. This ain't CNN news. This ain't American exceptionalism. This ain't the power of the preacher. But this must be God. And as you look back over your life, my question to you is crystal and clear. When you look back at your life and realize that the people that were using the same drugs as you are in jail, but you're not. And they were using the same stuff you were using, and they burnt out and in the hospital, and you healthy. And there are people that are more qualified for you than you in your position, but you got it. And you hadn't even seen a family function right, but God gave you a family. And even though you try to self-sabotage every day, the God that's in you is greater even than you. Then you ought to be able to say, it's not coinkydink, but it's God. Tell your neighbor, it's not coincidence, but it's God. I know my grandmama was praying, but she was praying to God. It's God. I know my mama and my daddy are good people, but it's God. I wish I had a church. I've learned in my life that it's God. When I look back over my life and I think things over, the only reason I'm standing is because it's God. I wish I had a neighbor. I got a job. That's God. I got food on my table. That's God. My children doing well. That's God. My wife is still alive. That's God. My church is strong. That's God. My community is safe. That's God. I wish I had a every now and then. You ought to pull out a sheet of paper and do the ledger for yourself. Oh, I got a raise on my job. That's God. Oh, my God loves me. That's God. Oh, I'm accomplishing my goals. That's God. You ought to know that is God. I am a convict that is convicted, convinced at the foot of the cross. And my prayer for you, before money, before honey, before Easter bunny, that's bars for you. My prayers for you is that you become truly convinced of who God is. Because God is the only God I know that you can take to hell and back. God is the only God that you can take to hell and back. Come on here, I'm a living witness. I've been through hell and high water, and I got my God in my tote bag, and I come to realize God is the best partner to be with. Come on here. You going to hell by yourself. You may mess around and stay, but I got God with me. See, you done threw me off. Stop that, stop that, stop that, stop that, stop that. Here is the irony of the text, Brother Caleb. Dad, that's a Marine. Caleb, that's Army, right there. He was crucified for being the thing that the soldier recognized. See, I ain't got time. Kim, I ain't got time, but they got to read their Bible. They took him and stripped him of his clothes and beat him because his accusation was blasphemy. That he said he was the Son of God. And at the end of this text, the ones who didn't believe him, their confession is, truly, he's the Son of God. Now, why do you bring that up? Because God told me, especially, this is just for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Are you? I don't know. People think they have you figured out. They have put you in a box and attempted to crucify you because they don't believe the God in you. Huh? But by the end of the summer, come on here. By the end of the week, come on here. It can be tomorrow if you just walk in it. Come on here. God will show himself strong and prove you to be everything they said you weren't. Do I have a witness? Give God some praise. You ain't going to have to prove it to them. They're going to see it. Because it was the truth in the first place. Conviction at the foot of the cross. Somebody give God praise. Come on, stand with me.
Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me. That's love.
Yeah, that's love.
That's love. Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me. That's
love. Love, love, love.
Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch.
Oh, that's love. That is love, yeah.
That's love.
Yeah.
Hung him high.
Hug him high.
Stretched him wide. He hung his head for me.
For me, he died.
That's love.
That ought to be your new jam right there. Come on, Sister Amy, sing it with me.
Oh, yeah.
That's not how.
He stretched him wide.
He hung his head.
For me, he died. That's love.
The story ends.
That's not how the story ends. 3 days later, he rose again. That's love. That's love.
Love, yeah.
But that's not how the story ends. 3 days
later,
he rose again. That's love.
Let me give you something. They used to sing it.
What it really means.
Come on, sing it, sister.
What it really means.
Come on, let's get some songing.
What it really means.
What it really means.
What it really means.
Because that's what it truly means.
What it really means.
Get some harmony.
What it really means.
What it really means.
What it really means.
To love. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for everyone under the sound of my voice. My prayer, God, is that they come to see you at the foot of the cross. My prayer is, God, that they will tear down the walls of religion in their life and develop a relationship with you. My prayer is that they will allow the very ground of the world to be upended for you to create a new landscape, new feet to ground to walk on. My prayer is, God, that you will raise the dead places in their lives, and they will testify to the goodness of the Lord, that I have seen the goodness of the Lord while I am yet in the land of the living. Come now by here, Lord. We need you, Lord, just as much today as any other day, knowing that tomorrow draws nigh and that we don't know the minute nor hour when you shall come again. Come, God, and continue to transform us. Come, God, and continue to grow us. Come now, God, and continue to be God in our lives. And as you do the work that only you can do, we'll be careful to give you all the honor, the glory, and the praise. Now, God, there is somebody in here that doesn't know you in the pardoning of their sins. And my prayer is, even now, that they will simply pray this simple prayer. They ain't got to walk down the aisles. They don't have to allow the foam to come down their mouth. They don't have to run and dance. All they have to say is, God, I am a sinner, and I accept you in my life. I know I couldn't do it by myself. God, I accept the gift of Christ that I may walk with you forever. I'm praying, God, for souls to be saved. I'm praying for salvation to be infectious and go in people's homes and go into people's families and go into the community. God, have your way. Let this Resurrection Sunday, God, not be an isolated Sunday, but let it be the first of many Sundays as we continue to walk with you, as you keep us in perfect peace, and as you order our steps that we might be pleasing unto you. Now to him who is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before the throne, the all-wise God, be all power, dominion, and glory. May that God go with you out of the building. May that God give you power to live. May that God encourage you in the midnight hour. May that God be your God, and as a result, your life and everybody's life around you be changed. And if that is your prayer, come on, somebody shout and say amen. Somebody shout and give God glory. Somebody shout and act a fool for the Lord. I don't know what else you have planned, but I will tell you this, and I'll say this again. This don't have to be the only time. You can visit us in the physical location, and you can visit us virtually. Why you keep saying that, preacher? Because you want members? No, because God wants people. We don't necessarily need members. God wants people. Like the old army slogan, he wants you. God wants you. And the easiest way to walk is to walk together. Unity, can you say that with me? The easiest way to walk is together. Go ahead and say it one more time. The easiest way to walk is together. That's why we're unity. Because even though we are many, we are unified under one God. Even though we are many, we are unified under one purpose. And we have decided that we are going to walk this walk together, bearing each other's burdens, laughing with each other, crying with each other, and pulling each other toward the goal of Jesus Christ. We invite you to this family. We invite you to this family. If you ever feel like coming around the way, somebody tell them, pull on up. Some of y'all don't even know what that means. Tell them again, pull on up. Because I truly believe that in these last days, the church will have to be more unified than ever before. Because I truly believe that in the last days, we will need each other to see God. So until we see each other again, live for God, love God, laugh for God, and all that other stuff. Amen. Come on, somebody, give God some praise. I think we out of here. Give somebody a hug, but I hope to see you some other time. Come on. Huh? Oh, we got donuts in the back. Somebody go ahead and get those donuts, but save Pastor One with child.